Hi children. I am Mrs. Vijayalakshmi Ramakrishnan, tutor for physics. Today I'll be covering the chapter Motion in a Straight Line. I'll briefly run through how to access the revision notes and test in clay style. Just a second. Hello. Yeah, I'm starting the class, children. Hello, everybody. I'm Mrs. Vijayalakshmi Ramakrishnan, tutor for physics subject. I'll be covering motion in a straight line today. I'll briefly run through how to access the revision notes and test in Clay 6 website. First of all, go to the clay6.com. Okay, go to the site clay6.com. You can as well click on the practice. And then you can select the NEET premium here. You have all the test series for all the three subjects, that is physics, chemistry, and biology. Now you can click on the various tests for physics, chemistry, and biology. Now I'll go to the revision notes. Let's see how to access this revision notes. In the revision notes, actually, we have, you can see, we have actually summarized everything, briefly, the whole chapter. It is chapter wise, and you can use, see, units and measurements right from first chapter to the last chapter for both 11th standard and the 12th standard we have. So you can as well go there and this is for new units and measurements. Now, today's chapter, I'm going to go with motion in a straight line. Okay. So, now look into this. Yeah. Basically, when I say motion in a straight, so both motion in a straight line and motion in a plane, they can come under one chapter called kinematics. Kinematics is a branch of mechanics, actually. It deals with study of motions of objects without considering the cause of motion. Okay. So here we are now going to see both when an object is at rest and object is at motion. Here, let us quickly see what are the main topics to be learned, like say motion in a straight line, say displacement. Now you all know displacement is a vector quantity. Yesterday we were talking about both the scalar quantity and the vector quantity. Scalar quantity has only magnitude, whereas vector quantity has both magnitude and direction. This is what I told you. And then the shortest distance from the initial position to the final position, that is called as the displacement. So the definition for displacement is the shortest distance from the initial position to the final position of the particle is called as displacement. So, A, suppose let us take a point A, x1, y1, z1, and B is x2, y2, z2. Then the displacement is now going to be x2 minus x1 times I plus y2 minus y1 j plus z2 minus z2, z2 k. Because we are now going to resolve the point into the three components, it is the I, J, and K vectors. Okay. Next comes the speed. Now you'll all know that speed is a scalar quantity. Speed is nothing but the distance traveled by time taken. Okay. Now, when I say uniform speed, it covers equal distances in equal intervals of time. Okay. So I can say, when I say motion in a straight line, I can actually say motion can be in 1, 2, and 3 dimensions. So when I say motion in a single dimension, it can be a linear motion or rectilinear motion. That is, it is now going to be along a straight line, say like this. It can be like this. Say from particular point A to particular point B. So motion along, so this examples I can say for one dimensional motion is motion of a train along a straight track, motion of a freely falling body. All these come under this particular topic of one dimensional motion. So when I say two dimensional motion, the motion of an object is said to be two dimensional for only two of the three coordinates. So here we saw three displacement for three coordinates, is it not? Instead of that, you are now going to have only for two coordinates, that is the x and the y coordinate. Okay, in that case, we say it is, so it is now more like this now. Okay. This is the origin, x axis and the y axis. So when I say this point A, it will have both the x coordinate and the y coordinate, right? So in that case, you say it is a two-dimensional motion. So in this case, the displacement would be more like x2 minus x1 times I, because always along the x-axis, it is now going to be the I vector, and along the y-axis, it is now going to be the j vector. Okay. So it is now going to be x2 minus x1 I plus y2 minus y1 j. So it is not going to be there. So examples for two-dimensional motion can be motion of planets around the sun, a car moving along a zigzag path on a level road, or these are examples for three-dimensional motion. Next comes the, two-dimensional motion. Now comes the three-dimensional motion. Three-dimensional motion, the motion of an object is said to be three-dimensional for all the three coordinates are known. Now, as we saw earlier, all the three coordinates, that is x, y, and the z, all the three components are now going to be included. Then we say, then more like it can be a motion in a space, you can say that. Okay. In that case, we say it is now going to be more of a three-dimensional motion. Now I can draw the diagram like this. See, it is now going to have all the three axes, x-axis, y-axis, and the z-axis. So along the, let this be origin. So along the x-axis, this is now going to be the I vector. Along the y-axis, it is now going to be the j vector, and along the z-axis, it is now going to be the j vector. Okay, k vector. Okay, it is now going to be the k vector. So examples for three-dimensional motion: a kite flying on a windy day, motion of an aeroplane in a space. All these can be examples, cited as examples for three-dimensional motion. Okay, next let us go to the distance and displacement. Yesterday I told you, we were distinguishing between the scalar quantities and the vector quantities. I told you that distance was a scalar quantity because it does not have direction, whereas displacement is now going to be a vector quantity because it has got both magnitude and direction. Okay. So when I say, so let us take this triangle ABC. Now let us say an object is traveling from A to B, then B to C, and then C to A. Now when I say what is going to be the total distance traveled, you say it is nothing but A, B plus B, C plus C, A. Okay. The total distance traveled is now going to be A, B plus B, C plus C. And the displacement in this case is also now going to be the same, A, B plus B, C plus C, A. Not in all cases distance and displacement are same. Like when you take a right triangle, okay, let us say it is now right angled at B. So what is now going to be the distance? Let us say the object is now going to be traveling from A to B and then B to C. Sorry, this is C. Let us say this is now going to be C. So the object, the total distance traveled, and then C to A, we can say the total distance traveled is now going to be AB plus BC. Okay. Now we can say that the distance traveled is equal to AB plus BC. Whereas when I say displacement, okay, when I say displacement, what did I tell you? Displacement is nothing but the shortest distance from the initial position to the final position. So in this case, you can see the shortest distance from the initial position to the final position is nothing but AC. So it is now simply AC. Okay, it is now going to be simply AC. So this is the difference between distance and displacement. Okay, then. Okay, so we now distinguished between the distance and displacement. Now coming to the speed, I told you speed is nothing but distance by travel, distance traveled by time taken. So I told you uniform speed is nothing but it covers equal distances in equal intervals of time. And non-uniform speed, it covers unequal distance in equal intervals of time. So the average speed is now going to be the total distance traveled by total time taken. Here, we are going to learn something more. That is the instantaneous speed. Okay, that is the instantaneous speed. So you can see this instantaneous speed is nothing but see. So suppose before that, let us now. So this is now going to be the average speed. I told you, yeah. This is now average speed. Okay. So suppose in a system of when you consider a system of particles, where there are now say the object is now going to be at a distance of x1, x2, x3 from the origin, and let the time taken for these particles to travel from the origin be t1, t2, t3. Then in that case, v will be equal to the algebraic sum of everything, that is x1 plus x2 plus x3 divided by t1 plus t2 plus 3. Okay, so the body now travels with the speed of v1, v2, v3. You can summarize, you can algebraically add everything and say x1 plus x2 plus x3 and so on divided by t1 plus t2 plus t3 and so on. Okay. Now I was talking about this instantaneous speed, right? Instantaneous speed. What is instantaneous speed? This is nothing but the speed of an object at any particular instant of time or a particular point of its path is called as instantaneous speed. Say for example, I can now specify it, say at the second, what happens? Or a body is traveling or an object is traveling at a uniform speed. What will be the velocity of the object at the 10th second or 5th second? Or what is now going to happen between the 5th second and the 10th second? You are more specific now. In that case, you call that as the instantaneous speed. So in that case, you can now put it as limit delta t tends to 0 delta x by delta y is equal to dx by dt. Okay. So we know how do you calculate the speed of the a car or something. So the speedometer of an automobile indicates the instantaneous speed. So instantaneous speed, you might be wondering how to calculate the instantaneous speed. So in this instant of an say a car is now traveling at a uniform speed. How to calculate the instantaneous speed? So the speedometer, which is now going to be in the automobile, will now indicate the instantaneous speed in any instant. Okay. Now, next, let us come to the velocity. Now, you know, yesterday also I was mentioning about the velocity. When I differentiated between the scalar quantity and the vector quantity, I was telling about this speed was the scalar quantity and velocity was the vector quantity. So we said that speed was distance traveled by time taken, whereas velocity, you know, it is now going to be the displacement by time taken. So that is why it is a vector quantity, because displacement is a vector quantity, velocity also becomes a vector quantity. Okay, what is uniform velocity? Uniform velocity, it has equal displacements in equal intervals of time. Okay, it has, there we said speed was, it covers equal distance in equal intervals of time. Just the same. Instead of distance, it is now going to be the displacement. That's it. Okay. Next is non-uniform velocity. Non-uniform velocity, it has non-equal displacements in equal intervals of time. Okay. The time is now going to be equal. Time interval is now going to be equal. Note. Okay. But the displacement or distance traveled or displacement or distance covered is not going to be the same. That is now going to be equal or unequal. In that case, you say it is now going to be a non-uniform motion or a uniform motion. Okay. Now, this coming to the equations of next is, so in short, you can put it as v is equal to x2 minus x1 by t2 minus. Okay. So v is equal to, again, v is a vector quantity. So we can now put v as v vector is equal to x2 minus x1 vector by t2 minus t1. Because it's now going to be a displacement, we are now giving it as a, we are now denoting as it as a vector quantity. Okay. Next comes the acceleration. Acceleration is nothing but the change in velocity by time taken. What is change in velocity? V2 minus V1 by T2 minus T1. Okay. Or in short, we can put it as del V by del T. A vector is equal. Again, acceleration is also a vector quantity. So A vector is equal to del V by del T. Now let us quickly go through this equation of motion, which you have studied in your earlier classes in the 9th and 10th classes. So equation of motion, V is equal to U plus AT, where V stands for initial velocity, U stands for initial velocity, V stands for final velocity, A for acceleration, and T for time. Okay. U, initial velocity, V, final velocity, A, acceleration, T is time. Now, S is equal to UT plus half AT squared, where here S is now going to be the distance. Okay. S is the distance covered. U is again the initial velocity, T is the time taken, and A is now going to be the acceleration. Okay. And then V squared is equal to U squared plus 2AS. Okay. V squared is equal to U squared plus 2AS. Here again, V for final velocity, U for initial velocity, A is the acceleration, and S is the distance traveled. Snth. S stands for distance, I told you. What will be the distance covered in that particular second? Distance traveled in the nth second. So that is given by U plus A by 2 times 2n minus 1. This is now going to be the distance traveled at the nth instant. Okay. Now, the same can be applied when the object is now going to be under free fall. This also you have studied earlier. Let us quickly go through that. Motion under gravity, or when the object is under free fall. Okay. Freely falling object, which is influenced by acceleration due to gravity. That is G. So here we can now say that U is equal to zero. When U is equal to zero, the first equation, instead of A, we are now going to put only G. Okay. We are now going to put G. Now, you'll have to note that the object is now going to be under free fall. You can say that instead of A, we are now going to put G. Okay. So when it is under the influence of gravity, it is now going to be plus G. Okay. So A is equal to plus G. So V is equal to the first equation. Now, since it is now going to fall from rest, it is now going to be U is zero, so alpha is G. So the first equation now becomes zero plus GT, or V is equal to simply G. So V is equal to GT is going to be the first equation. So S is now going to be equal to, when I substitute G for the second equation, then it becomes S is equal to UT plus half GT squared. So in that place, you have, see now, since U is equal to zero, it simply becomes H is equal to half GT squared. And for the third equation, it is now going to be V squared is equal to U squared plus 2AS. So it becomes V squared is equal to simply 2GH or HAT squared. Okay. So distance fallen in the time T1 2t, 3t, like that it goes on. T1, 2t, 3t, etc. will be in the ratio. You can see it is now going to be in the ratio. 1 is to 3 is to 5. Okay. So this is the case when the object is now going to be under the influence of gravity, or when the object is off, when it is falling freely. Okay. What is now going to be the case when the object is projected upwards? Okay. In that case, it now becomes V is equal to 0. Then A is equal to minus G. Remember, when the object is falling down, it is now going to be plus G. When the object is now projected up, it is now going to be minus G. It is going against gravity, so we take it as minus G. Okay. So in that case, it now, in all those cases, it is now going to be minus G. Okay. Remember that. So U is equal to GT. H is equal to half GT squared. U squared is equal to 2GH. Okay. So if H is given, T is equal to root of. So if H is, if you are, if the value of H is given, then you can see T is equal to root of 2H by G, and U is equal to root of 2GH. So these formula you'll have to be knowing by heart, okay, while solving these problems, because the questions you can expect from motion in a plane is almost 0 to 1 questions. So at least one question can be asked. Okay. And then weightage in percentile, if I say it is now going to be 1.5. The weightage for this particular motion in plane alone is now going to be 1.5. So when it comes to exams point of view, you'll have to consume time, I told you. You'll have to be very careful with your time, management of time. So if you are going to be thorough with all these formula, then it is going to be pretty easy. That is why we are now releasing this revision notes, and we are asking you to go through this every time, so that you'll be aware of all the formula every time. Every time you need not go the whole thing, you need not derive everything, and that is now going to be a big procedure, is it not? So you can as well learn all these formula by heart, and then apply this, and every time you'll have to read the problem and quickly note what is being asked, what are the data given, read through the question once or twice, and then quickly understand what is being asked and what are the data given. Accordingly, you can use the different formula which has been given here. Okay. So I will do relative velocity tomorrow along with motion with a straight motion in a plane. So today we'll stop here and quickly go to the problems. Okay. Yeah. Now you can see the first. Go to this. Now, I told you yesterday, again, I'm repeating, the blue bubble is indicates that you have not taken the test. Okay. And R is going to be the red bubble where you can take the random test. And green bubble is the one which indicates that you have taken the test already. Now I'll go to the first test. We have lots of tests you can as well take. See, we have given test chapter wise. And you can take this, even though you have taken this test once, you can go again, go through it once again. You can take the test any number of times. Okay. So look at this. Take a test. Click on that. Go to test. Now this appears. Okay. Okay. Now going to the first question. A body covers half of the journey at 40 kilometers per hour and seconds half at 60 kilometers per hour, second half it is at 60 kilometers per hour speed. Find the average speed of the whole journey. This is what is being asked. Okay. Now let us quickly solve this. Let me clear the page. Okay. Yeah. Now you know average speed is total distance by total time taken. Okay. So let us say 2s is now going to be the, let us say 2s is now going to be the total distance traveled. Okay. 2s is the total distance traveled. Okay. So total time taken is now going to be, total time is equal to s by 40 plus s by 60, which is equal to s by 24. When you take the LCM and simplify that, you get it as s by 24. Okay. Now, what is now going to be the total time? It is now going to be 3s plus 2s divided by 240. Sorry. Because this is now going to be s by 24 and this, this is now going to be 120, which is now going to be 5s by 120. Okay. Now I can cancel 5 and 120 and I get it as 24. So average speed is now going to be 2s by s by 24, which is equal to this s and s will get cancelled. This 24 goes up. It now becomes 48 kilometers per hour. Okay. So let's see which option shows that. So option B, let me click that. Okay. Now save that and go to the next question. A body is moving due north at 10 meters per second. In 1 second, the velocity changes to 10 meters per second due east. Find the average acceleration of the body. Okay. Let me solve that for you. First, he says it is now going due north. Okay. Let us say it is north. And then east. 10 meters per second east. Here also 10 meters per second. Okay. So let me complete the parallelogram. So obviously this is now going to be the resultant. So this is more like a right triangle. Now I can take it as, now what is the average velocity? Average velocity is root of 10 squared plus 10 squared. The resultant velocity is 10 squared plus 10 squared, which is equal to 10 root 2. Okay, 10 root 2. So that is now going to be the average velocity. Now you know the average acceleration is nothing but average velocity by average time taken. So that is now going to be 10 root 2. And the time taken given is 1, which is equal to 10 meters per second squared. Okay, that was quite simple. So let's see which option. D option is correct. Okay. Now let's go to the next one. Save and go to the next question. A body is moving along a straight line with a constant acceleration and has velocities 6 meters per second and 8 meters per second at points A and B of its path. Find the velocity at the midpoint of A. Okay. Let me clear. Okay. Now let us draw the straight line. Let us take this point as A and this as B. C is the midpoint, he says. So at A it is 6 meters per second. And at B, it is 8 meters per second. So now, you know, since C is the midpoint, AC is equal to CB. Let us take it as some S. Okay. So acceleration at C, let us take it as V. Velocity at C is V vector. Okay. So, you know, let us now take the third equation. V squared minus U squared is equal to 2AS. Right. So V squared minus 6 squared is equal to 2AS. Same way. For this, it is now going to be the final velocity is now going to be A. Okay. Remember, so it is now going to be 8 squared minus B squared is equal to 2AS. Now subtract both so that you can eliminate 2AS. So that gives you 2V squared is equal to 64 plus 36 is now going to be 100, or V squared is equal to 50, or V is equal to square root of 50, which is equal to 5 root 2 meters per second. Okay. 5 root 2 meters per second. So let's see which option is correct. See. Let's see the next question. Coming to the fourth question. A ball is thrown vertically upwards from ground and a student gazing out of the window sees it moving upwards past him at 5 meters per second. The window is 10 meters above the ground. Find the maximum height of the ball. Okay, let us quickly solve this. It's pretty easy. Again, we can use the equation V squared minus u squared is equal to 2as. Here u is being asked, what is u? Given b is equal to 5 meters per second and s is equal to 10 meters. And a is given as minus 10 because it is retardation. So it is now, you're taking it as negative 10. Okay. So just substitute the values. That will give you 5 squared minus u squared is equal to 2 into minus 10 times 10. Or u squared is equal to, this is now going to be 200 minus 25. That gives you 200 plus 25. That gives you 225. Or h, you know, maximum height h is given by, he is asking you for the maximum height. We have just found out, so you can say u is equal to 15, square root of 225 is 15. But we are not asked, to find out u now. Instead, we are asking, he is asking you for the maximum height. Okay, so h is equal to u squared by 2g. This is what I told you. Whenever the object is now going to be under free fall, I told you h is now going to be equal to u squared by 2g. That is, now in the case place of u squared, let us substitute 225 divided by 2. Let us take g as 10. So when you simplify, you get h to be equal to 11.25 meters. Let's see which option is correct. Option A is correct. Save that and go to the next one. Okay. The correct statement from the following is, which is now going to be the correct statement. A body having zero velocity will not necessarily have zero acceleration. A body having zero velocity will necessarily have zero acceleration. A body having non-uniform speed can have only uniform acceleration. A body having non-uniform velocity will have zero acceleration. Okay. Let us look into the statements. Which of the following statement is now going to be correct? Okay. Let me clear this. For a body, when it is projected vertically upwards, I said at the highest point, the velocity is always zero. Okay. Remember, at the highest point, whenever the object is now going to be projected upwards, the velocity at the highest point is zero. In that case, acceleration is not going to be zero because still it is now going to be under the influence of acceleration due to gravity g. So g is not zero here. So even though the velocity is zero, the acceleration is not zero. So which of the statement do you think will be correct? Obviously, it is now going to be A, because that states that a body having zero velocity will not necessarily have zero acceleration. So that option should be correct. Let us now pick that and save that. Okay. Going to the next question. A particle moves along a semicircle of radius 10 meters in 5 seconds. The average velocity of the particle in meters per second is what? Okay. This is pretty easy. But students tend to make mistake when it comes to circular motion. Here we'll have to take the displacement because it is velocity. It is the velocity being asked. Okay. So average velocity is equal to total displacement by time taken. Okay. Total displacement by time taken. Now when you say semicircle, let me draw the semicircle. It is now going to be like this. With center O. Now, you know, this is R and this is R. Let us take this as AB. So, the displacement is now going to be pi R. Sorry, the distance, the circumference of the semicircle is now going to be pi R. Okay. Now, but we know the displacement is now going to be the shortest distance. That is from, it is now starting from A, then going along the circle, this curve, and then ending at B. So when I say displacement, it is going to be AB, not pi r. Remember that. Okay. It is not going to be pi r, but instead it is now going to be AB. What is AB now? AB is nothing but 2r. Okay. AB is now 2r. So the radius given is 10. So AB, the displacement is now going to be 20 now. Okay. Displacement is 20. So what is going to be the time taken? So average velocity is now going to be equal to, the time taken is 5. So 20 by 5, which is equal to 4 meters per second. Let us see which option is correct. Option A is correct. Okay. Let us save that and go to the next question. Next. A ball is thrown upwards from a bridge where an initial velocity of 4.9 meters per second, with an initial velocity of 4.9 meters per second. It strikes the water after 2 seconds. If g is equal to 9.8 meters per second squared, what is the height of the bridge? Here also, the object is now going to be under free fall. And he is asking you to find out the height in this case. Okay, let me clear this. Now let us take the point of projection as the origin. And now since it is now going in the downward direction, g is now going to be positive. Okay, g is positive plus g cube. Okay. Since height is being asked, which equation do you think can we take? Obviously, the second equation, that is s is equal to ut plus half gt square. It is now going to be plus, so we can just put it as plus gt square. Instead of s, I can now put it as h also. H is equal to s is equal. Okay. Now substitute the values given. U is equal to 4.9, g is 9.8, and t is 2. Since the height is now going downwards, we have to take this as a negative thing. So u is now going to be 4.9. So 4.9 into 2 plus half into 9.8 into 2 into 2. So cancel this. Now you get it as 19.6. When you simplify and then finish it off, you get, add and find it out. Now you can see, you have to be careful while solving this. Here we take u to be negative. Okay. So it is now going to be 19.6. minus 9.8, which is equal to 9.8 meters. Okay. So let us see which option is correct. We have to take, remember here we are taking, since it is now going in the downward direction, we are now taking the velocity, here the u to be as minus 4.9. Okay. So it is now going to be 9.8. Let's see which option is correct. Yes, B is correct. Let us save that and go to the next one. Eighth one. A balloon is rising steadily at 5 meters per second. When it reaches a height of 30 meters, a stone is dropped from it. After how much time will the stone reach the ground? So the balloon is going at a velocity of 5 meters per second. When it reaches a height of 30 meters, the stone is dropped from it. After how much time will it reach the ground? Let's see. Okay, now it is given. He's asking you, when will it reach? So we can use the second formula. S is equal to ut plus half. Since it is in the downward direction, we can take g to be positive. So gt is 5. Okay, same way here also we'll have to take minus 5. Remember, so s is equal. So s is given as 30 here. Okay, s is equal to 30. U is now going to be minus 5 meters per second. And then g is 9.8, okay? Or in this case, we can take it as 10, okay? Let us take it as 10 because we need to have a quadratic, we'll form a quadratic equation and then solve it. So let us have it as a whole number, 10 meters per second, okay? Let us take it as 10 meters per second. So in this case, it is now going to be minus 5t, okay? Minus 5t plus half into 10 into t square. We need to find t, right? So we don't know t, so t square. Let us have this. So cancel this, that becomes 5t square. So it becomes 30 is equal to minus 5t plus 5t square. Okay? Or you can simply find it as 5t square minus 5t minus 30 is equal to 0. Okay? Or divide throughout by 5, that will give you t squared minus t minus 6 is equal to 0. Now, on factorizing, you will get it as t minus 3 times t plus 2 is equal to 0. Okay? T minus 3 times. Obviously, you know, t should be equal to either 3 or minus 2. So, since time can't be negative, we'll neglect this value. So, t should be equal to 3 seconds. So, let's see which option is correct. D option is correct. Save that and go to the next. The position x of a particle varies with time as x is equal to at squared minus bt cubed. The acceleration of the particle will be 0 at time t is equal to what? What is now going to be the acceleration? This is what is being asked. Okay. See, this is now quite simple. Now he has given you x is equal to at squared minus bt cubed. Now, you know, when you differentiate velocity, you'll get, when you differentiate distance, you'll get velocity. And when you differentiate velocity, you'll get acceleration. Okay. So let us differentiate this. So dx with respect to t, I'll get it as 2at minus 3bt squared. Okay. 3bt squared. So to find out the acceleration, I'll have to again differentiate this. That is d squared x by dt squared is equal to, that will give me 2a minus 6bt. Okay. Now, this is now going to be 0. We have to find out t now, right? To find out t, let us take the acceleration to be 0. In that case, it is now going to be t is 2a is equal to 6bt, or t is equal to 2a by 6b, which is equal to a by 3. Let's see which option is correct. A by 3b. Yes. Option C is correct. Save that. Go to the next. A ball takes t seconds to fall from a height of h1 and 2t seconds to fall from a height h2. Then h1 by h2 is what? This is pretty easy. Very easy. Okay. Let us now go to this question. Okay. Now, I told you, whenever the object is now going to be under free fall, then h is given by half gt squared. Okay. So, h1 is now going to be equal to half gt squared. And h2 will be, it is 2 times the time, he says. So, 2t the whole square. Now, divide both. Half and half gets cancelled, GG get cancelled, T squared gets cancelled. It is now going to be 1 is to 4 or 0.1 by 4, which is equal to 0.25. Okay, let's see which option is correct. 0.25, D is correct. Save that. Go to the next question. A car is able to stop with a uniform retardation of 8 meters per second squared. And the driver of the car can react to an emergency in 0.6 seconds. Calculate the overall stopping distance of the car if the speed of the car is 72 kilometers per hour. See, the acceleration or the retardation, the negative acceleration is given as 8 meters per second squared. And the speed is now given as 72 kilometers per hour. So you need to convert this to meters per second. Okay. First of all, first step you need to do is to convert this velocity, okay, to meters per second. So, let us take u is equal to, given as 72 kilometers per hour. Convert that. That will give you 72 into 1000 divided by 3600. So, that gives you 20 meters per second. Okay. Okay. In the first case, he says it is going to be 0.6 seconds. It travels with constant velocity of 20 meters per second. And it covers a distance. So let us now take that distance to be d1. That is equal to u into t. Velocity into time taken. That is equal to the distance, you know, is speed into time taken. Your velocity into time taken, which is nothing but 20 into 0.6, which is equal to 12 meters. Okay, so D1 is now going to be 12 meters. Then the distance D2, that is after applying the brakes, is now going to be, now here we can take this equation, V squared is equal to U squared minus 2AS, because it is now going to be retardation, right? So that is why I'm giving you, it is now going to be U squared minus 2AS. So final velocity, because the car comes to a stop, it is now going to be 0 is equal to 20 squared minus 2 into, acceleration is given as 8 into, we don't know D2, let us calculate this D2. So from this we find out D2 is equal to 20 squared is now going to be 400, and after finding out that will give you 25, 400 by 16, that gives you 25 meters. So what is it going to be, the total stopping distance? D is now going to be D1 plus D2, which is equal to 12 plus 25, which is equal to 37 meters. Let's see which option is correct. 37, option A is correct. Save that, go to the 12th. An electron starts from rest, has a velocity that increases linearly with time, that is B is equal to KT, where K is equal to 2 meters per second square. The distance covered in the first 3 seconds. Okay. So he is asking you for the distance covered. Let us take that distance covered to be ds is equal to k times t into ds. Now you know s is equal to half kt square, right? So I have differentiated that actually. S is equal to half kt square h. Okay, that in that case, so I have differentiated and I have taken, so 2 and 2 will get cancelled. So I get ds is equal to kt into ds. Okay. Now substitute the values. It is now going to be half into, I'm going to substitute in this. Okay. I'm going to substitute this. Half into K is 2 into time is 3 into 3, which is equal to 9 meters. Let's see which option is correct. 9 meters. So first option is correct. Save that and go to the 13th. A body moving in a straight line covers a distance of 14 meters in the 5th second and 20 meters in the 8th second. And 20 meters in the 8th second. How much distance will it cover in the 15th second? So this is being asked. Okay. So let us go to this. So it is clear that we are now making use of the instantaneous speed here. So we'll have to use the formula. Sn is equal to u plus a by 2 times 2n minus 1. So s5, 5th second. So it is now going to be s5 u plus acceleration is 9. Okay. So 9 by 2 times, sorry, acceleration, let's see what the acceleration is. So he says it is 14 meters. Distance covered is 14 meters in the 5th second. Okay. So it is now going to be, so in the place of 5, I'll put it as 2 into 5, 10, 10 minus 1, 9. So 9a. Okay. 9a by 2. Let us have this as the first equation. And then at the 8th second, it's now going to be s8, which is equal to u plus 8 into 2, 16. 16 minus 1 is going to be 15. So 15a by 2, let it be the second equation. And then we'll have to solve these two equations. Okay. On solving these two equations, you can now either add and find out, or you can now see that u is equal to, you can find out that u is equal to 5 meters per second and a is equal to 2 meters per second square. Now substitute that in S15. That gives you U plus, now you know 15 is, 15 2s are 30. 30 minus 1 is 29A. So 29A by 2. Substitute, we know U, we know A. Then substitute. That gives you 5 plus 29 into 2 by 2, which gives you 34 meters. Okay. Let's see which option is correct. Option C is correct. Save that. Go to the next. Raju drops a pile of marbles from the top of a roof located 8.52 meters above the ground. Determine the time required for the marbles to reach the ground. Okay. Let's solve. So we can use the formula S is equal to UT plus half AT squared. Okay. UT plus half AT squared. Now we are going to take, you know, the usual thing. S is now going to be distance, U is the initial velocity, T time taken, A is acceleration and everything. So we are now going to take, since it is now going to the body is falling down, that is the height is now going to be downward, so I'm going to take it as minus 8.52. okay, that is equal to initial velocity is zero, so zero into T plus half into, here it is now going to be G, right? So G, that is 9.8 into T squared. Okay, or now it gives you, this is now going to be again minus GT, so it is now going to be minus 9.8. So that is now going to be minus 8.52 is equal to minus 4.9 T squared, or T squared is equal to, the negative and negative sign gets cancelled. So that gives you 8.52 divided by 4.9, which is equal to 1.32 seconds. Let's see which option is correct. 1.32, option D is correct. Save that and go to the next. Dhoni throws his bat vertically upwards with an initial velocity of 26.2 meters per second. Determine the height to which the bat will rise above its initial height. Okay. Let's solve that. Here, given U is equal to, it is now, he is throwing up, so let us take it as plus 26.2 meters per second. Okay. And then final velocity, since it is now going to go at a height and then stop, right? So final velocity V is equal to zero. And A, let us, since it is now going up, we are now going to take it as minus 9.8 here. Okay. So we can use the equation B squared is equal to U squared plus 2GS, or here it is now going to be minus 2GS, right? 2GS. So final velocity is zero here. U squared is 26.2 the whole square minus 2 into, I have substituted here, minus, so you need not put minus 9.8 again. Okay, just put it as minus 9.8 into S. We need to find S, right? Or it is now going to be 26.2 the whole squared is equal to 2 into 9.8, or therefore S is now going to be equal to 26.2 the whole squared divided by 2 into 9.8. Now that works out to 35.02, or I can approximately write it as 35 meters. Let's see which option is correct. 35, option A is correct. Okay, so now we have completed the test. Let's see. Let's click on the end the test. Yes. The results are now loading. You can see the results. Just a second. I think some wrong pages clicked on. Yeah. Let me see. I did this test. Yeah. Yeah, I think some technological error. So once you take the test and complete it, yeah, this is how you go to the test. And finally, once you have finished the test, you can go click the end the test. Then it says yes. It will result. The results will be loading. You can see. Okay. The incorrect questions will be zero. Others will be marked green. Okay. Since the, I mean, there was some technological error, I think. So that is why it didn't show. But otherwise, the correct questions and incorrect questions. Correct questions will be green in color, incorrect will be red in color, and unanswered will be yellow in color. So you can as well check your answers. Whichever is incorrect, you can go and click to that box. So suppose if question one was incorrect, you can go and check that. See, the question is here and the explanation is also scroll down. See, you can see the explanation part here. Okay. See, the explanation part is now given here and you can verify your answers. Yeah. So that is how you take the test and finally end it. So with this, we are now coming to the end of this session. So you can now as well see that we have the NEET packages. Okay. We have 102 tests, chapter wise tests. As I told you, you can take the any number of tests, any number of times. There are full length tests also. Okay. You can go. So when I, you can see the full length test or NEET tests also there. Okay. And you can also ask your questions. We have the ask feature here. There you can go to our site. And we also have the chat support for Telegram for Clay6 student help board. So you can also get one-to-one classes with the tutors. For any other inquiries, you can also send email to info@clay6.com. So see you all tomorrow. Thank you then. Until then, goodbye children. Have a nice day.